So my talk is going to make the claim that participatory AI is better than explainable AI. And what I mean by participatory AI is some kind of a hybrid system between human beings and machine learning, similar to this system that you see on the screen, where you have a half bird, half flying machine. So to start with, my background is cognitive science. And as you can see, it is the most interdisciplinary enterprise on the planet, with 6 or 7 disciplines connected together. So education is one of the participating disciplines, and that is where I work currently, where I study human learning, particularly how novices discover new concepts. And I have done some work in artificial intelligence, particularly machine learning, of how memory emerges from non-memory systems. And this you can think of as an expert discovering new concept. And the claim that I would make in the the paper today is that there is an emerging interaction possible between these two types of learning, and they could inform and shape each other. So here is some background history of artificial neural networks. It was originally built in 1940s by McCulloch and Pitts, and then the system developed through many iterations, and one of them is the perceptron, and then there is the backpropagation algorithm, there is the recurrent neural network, and the deep learning system. And as you can see, all of them were developed by cognitive psychologists, people or cognitive scientists, and they developed these systems to model particular cognitive phenomena such as language, like text-to-speech, speech-to-text, etc., visual perception, writing recognition, object recognition, etc., and motor control, like human movements, robot movements, etc. And even after 80 years of doing this artificial neural network modeling, we still don't understand how the network actually works. So it is still a black box. Now, recently, this black box system has been extended to physical sciences. And this is a famous paper that shows a machine learning system based on artificial neural networks can learn condensed matter physics. Another one that shows ANN can learn Rubik's Cube, the God algorithm in Rubik's Cube, which was originally discovered using group theory. And then there is a polymer chemistry case where the machine learning system learns polymer conformation, and another case where the machine learning system learns to optimize quantum dynamics. In all these cases, there is this problem of what is called explainable AI, and it goes like this. To make discoveries similar to artificial neural networks, humans need to use complex theoretical models. Now, because humans use formal models, artificial neural network models are considered to act as if they contain formal model equivalents, such as Ising model, group theory, quantum mechanics, etc. Now, the explainable AI problem is we need to develop an account of how artificial neural networks build such internal equivalents of formal models. Now, I'm going to say that there are at least 4 problems with this view, and then I will develop an alternative account. So here is the first problem. Explainable AI is not change-oriented. So what do I mean by that? So here is a plane that is breaking the sound barrier, and obviously that plane's wings don't flap. So aircraft wings don't flap, and that changed our ideas about flight. Now, supersonic flight is possible because of this design change. Now, similarly, AlphaGo plays Go very differently from humans, and that has changed our ideas about Go playing. And expert Go players now learn from AlphaGo's strategies. So ANNs might be similar in that they may not be building human-like models, and their discovery processes could be fundamentally different and novel. Now, if that is the case, then new ANN designs could lead us to novel approaches to discovery, particularly integrating humans and machines in new ways, as you can see in this flying machine. And a second problem is that explainable AI is amorphous. Like if you come go very close to the problem, you will realize that it is a little like cotton candy. So the common thread that integrates the modeling based on artificial neural networks across cognition and physical sciences is the idea that ANNs work as something like an emergence machine, where you start with a micro feature, like you give micro features as input, and then you get some kind of macro structure as output. For example, in the case of cognition models, the microstructures that could be fed in could be pixel data or phoneme data or something. And what you get as an output is picture categories or like text or sentences or something like that. Now, in the case of science models, one of the microstructure features could be like atomic structure data. And what you get at the macro structure could be continuum data or grain data or something like that. Now, in the case of cognition models, it is very clear what the nature of the model is. The model works as a classifier, which is a neuron-based model of category formation, like particularly how the brain develops categories. While in the case of the science models, it is totally unclear what is the nature of the model. So is it still a classifier? Is it a mechanism model? Is it an algorithm? Is it an analogy? Is it a new theory? Or is it some mix of all these things? So, and what that means is that explainable AI is not very clear on what it is trying to explain. Now, a third problem is that the explainable AI position misses an elephant in the room. And to this requires a little bit of unpacking. So I'm going to do some unpacking of the nature of modeling. So when people are studying how models produce new knowledge, there are two positions that are taken, like models act as mirrors or models act as tools. So so you start with the world, and then there is some phenomena in the world that you are interested in understanding, let us say oscillation, and then you build a symbol-based machine, which is a model, which, you know, like an equation of oscillation or a computational model of oscillation, and you try to explain like how that model fits with the world. But there is also this other component, which is the mind. The mind is the structure that is building the model, and it is also the structure that is fitting the data and then agreeing that the model actually works as a model. Now, this component is usually ignored in this analysis of how modeling gives you formal knowledge, because it is very difficult to understand. So traditionally, the models were only understood as correspondence machines, like they were understood as mirroring the world. And the question that was asked in those kind of analysis was, how does the symbol-based model correspond to the world? This is typically asked in the philosophy of science, particularly realism. And explainable AI is a version of this correspondence. Now, recently, people have started looking at the mind's contribution more seriously, particularly now that we have some way of theorizing about it. And we now try to understand models as concept-changing machines. That is, models change concepts about reality, particularly human concepts. Now, the question that is asked in this case is, how does building the symbol-based model, that is the process of modeling, lead to new concepts about the world? And this question is usually asked in cognitive science, philosophy of science or practice, which is a subset of philosophy of science, and which is a new discipline, and then science education. And science education requires this understanding, that you need to understand how models change concepts. That is where I focus on, and this is the area that I come from. Now, when you look at artificial neural network models, and you start with this idea that there is a world, there is a machine, and there is a mind. So what the artificial neural network models of cognition do is that they try to understand the brain, which is the part of the world that is related to cognition. So you replace the world with the brain. And then you build a system that is sort of roughly similar to the brain. So they have artificial neural networks have structures similar to the brain in the sense neurons, synapses, connections, strings, firings, etc. They are like what you have in the system is like inspired by the brain. And they have a network structure similar to the brain. They have a learning structure similar to the brain. And they also have what is called graceful degradation structure. So the idea here is that if you slash this network, there are a lot of slashing studies, the network will not completely crash, but it will still behave like a functioning brain, similar to people who are very aged or like people who have Alzheimer's disease or somebody who has had a stroke or something like that. So this is considered an advantage of this system because it approximates not only a functioning brain, but it also approximates a brain that has been compromised. So basically, the system works like a brain. Now, the system that is studied here is the brain. The system that is modeling the brain sort of works like a brain. And the system that is trying to understand it is also a brain. But given all this isomorphism, we still don't understand how the system actually work on. It allows you to model the brain. Now, so the artificial neural network models of physical science, they replace the brain with the world. So here, now you have taken the brain and then you have replaced it with the world. But then what you don't do is that you don't take the network completely seriously. So what you do is you ignore the brain-like structure of artificial networks. neural networks and the network structure of artificial neural networks, the learning and memory structure of artificial neural networks, and the graceful degradation structure of artificial neural networks. Even though they are all there, you just sort of ignore it. So they are, these networks are treated as just micro to macro mapping functions. That is the, I mean, the idea is that that is the only thing that these networks do. So it can now model, you know, physical science phenomena. Now the problem with this thing is it creates what I am calling the elephant problem. Because the ANN models still embed brain structure, ANN models of physical science do not model reality. So this is a critique that can be raised against such models. They model how brains learn about reality. So the physical science papers that are, you know, talking about condensed matter physics, quantum mechanics, like Rubik's Cube and all that, you know, they are basically learning about condensed matter physics. Like artificial networks are learning about condensed matter physics. But they are basically models of how brains learn condensed matter physics, how brains learn quantum mechanics, how brains learn Rubik's Cube, etc. So they model science learning. Now this doesn't seem to be a problem yet, but you know, if this is a problem, then there is even more bigger problem, which I am going to call the T-Rex problem or the Kraken problem. So Kraken is something like the underwater version of, ocean version of the Kraken, T-Rex. So the Kraken problem goes like this. So ANNs are designed to model plasticity, as we saw. Like if they have learning memory network structure and graceful degradation. But now they are considered to be a model of, that is, they are considered to correspond to physical systems with no plasticity. That is, they have no learning, no memory, no network structure, and no graceful degradation. So how can a plastic system be a model of non-plastic systems? So this looks like a deal breaker, but then there are ways of getting around it. So possible ways to address this problem, even though that is, this is not either the problem or its, you know, solution is not discussed in the literature. So one way you can get out of it is to say that artificial neural networks do not model plasticity. So they are just gradient descent algorithms, or they are Markov processors or something like that. Now this is the position taken by computer science. But then cognitive science people will complain, because ANNs were designed to model plasticity and they are useful because they design plasticity. So they are different and they are useful, and they provide a completely different way of approaching modeling problems. So how can you throw this out? The other option is, so if that option is out, so the next option is to say that physical systems do have plasticity. So that way the system is, you know, appropriate for modeling physical systems. But then this is not a very popular view. Maybe recently in material science and condensed matter physics and all, people are looking at memory materials, smart materials, spin glasses, all those kind of systems that are showing some kind of memory and learning and all. But generally speaking, physical systems are not considered to have learning and memory and graceful degradation. So physical science will complain, because this position needs a new data, new theory, and new scientific paradigm, and nobody wants to go there. So this option is also out, which leaves you the third option, which is to say that models do not correspond to anything. Now, of course, philosophers will complain here, but they always complain, so it is not a problem. And also, like, you know, artificial neural networks have developed through philosophical discussions, productive discussions with philosophers. So cognitive science has a very productive relationship with philosophy, sort of little dysfunctional, but very productive. So this is the route that I'm going to take here. So I will claim that from, based on some papers that we have written, I have written with a philosopher of science, that we can treat models as dynamic systems. So here what happens is you treat the symbolic system that is created as a dynamic system, which enacts the world. So it co-varies with changes in the world. On the other side, it also enacts the mind, in the sense that it co-varies with mind changes that are linked to the world. So the system is a dynamic system. And it couples the mind and the world. So this is the relationship that it has. Now what this allows you to do is to resolve the Kraken problem in a sort of kind of way, where you say that because ANN models are enactive systems, so the references are there in these two papers. I mean, the detailed argument is there in the two papers. So ANN models are enactive systems which couple the brain and the world. They do not correspond to anything. So you don't say that, you know, normally other, you know, like dynamic systems correspond to anything, like tornadoes don't correspond to anything. And what they are, they are technologies, they are artifacts built by engineering sciences. And ANN models does work as tools to change both the brain and reality. So this is the approach that I will take, and I will develop two analysis based on this approach, which is a non-correspondence approach and a non-explainable AI approach. So the two analyses are, phase one, I will argue that modeling works as an optimization engine. And in phase two, I will argue that modeling works as a mind redesign engine. So here is phase one. So here are two bridges. So the first one is in Spain, in Alcantara, and it was built in 106 AD. And it is a design that is based on implicit, embodied, and internal models, because that is the only models that were available at that point. And then the other one is the Golden Gate Bridge, which is across the San Francisco Bay, and it was built in 1937 AD. So 2000 years later, where you had formal, explicit, and external model. So this is a design based on such model. So I will sort of unpack the details of these two designs. So this bridge was designed when we did not know how to design bridges. What do I mean by that? So stress, strain, corrosion, fluid dynamics, aerodynamics, resonance, etc., did not exist as explicit concepts at that point. So the Alcantara designers used these factors, but in an implicit and embodied fashion. So they knew it, but they were sort of, all these factors were sort of combined together in their body, and they were using it in that way. Now, this bridge was built after physics built formal models of these explicit factors, which made these factors explicit and external. So once they were explicit, these different physical factors could be dissociated. Like in the case of the embodied understanding, they were all clustered together in an amorphous kind of way. But once they were formally modeled, you can sort of separate them out. And then you can recombine them. And these recombinations showed ideal limit conditions, so which we could study. And these limit conditions showed how factors could interact in yet to exist situations. So now you had the capability to develop synthesized materials to meet these yet to exist conditions, which we could see in advance. And then novel designs thus emerged from many iterations of this. So you build explicit models which allow dissociation, recombination, and idealization of factors, which allowed you to develop new kinds of synthesized new materials and new designs. And this led to the building of the San Francisco Bridge, which is across a sea, while the previous embodied designs were across small rivers or lakes. Now, there are lots of other cases. So here is the flying machine that was built using implicit knowledge. And then explicit modeling led to this Panzer flying machine. Now, here are the stone throwing machines we had before using implicit knowledge. And then we had explicit models, and you have these fancy flyer, you know, throwing machines which throw things more than stones. And here are the batteries and induction coils, which we created with implicit knowledge. And then Faraday played with these things and then created data, which was explained using the theory of electromagnetism by Maxwell. And then that led to all these fancy gadgets that we work with currently. And then here is a biological case, very interesting. So every organism knows how to reproduce implicitly. And after we had a formal model of reproduction, we can now have test tube babies and other reproductive technologies that we currently have. So explicit model works as the engine of optimization. So you can think of modeling as an optimization engine, where you first build systems that manifest new phenomena, like new flying machines, like stone throwing machines, or like electromagnetism, even thermodynamics. And then what you do is you model these things, these phenomena, using explicit models, and then you explore limit cases and trade-offs using this coupling process. And then you rebuild the systems based on the exploration of limit cases and trade-offs, so you get all these fancy systems. Now, that is a little too neat, because there are lots of cases where explicit models, there are a lot of counter examples to this, where explicit models are not necessary for discovery, and we still make discoveries. So one of the famous cases is glass. So glass was discovered many, you know, like a few centuries back. And then like telescopes and microscopes came from there, from glass, which created the scientific revolution. But we still don't have a good theory of how glass forms, which hasn't prevented us from creating all this fancier glass, like fluoride glass, ultra-thin glass, floor glass and all. Another case is paracetamol, which has been around for more than 100 years, and we have been eating paracetamol for more than 100 years. But we still don't understand how paracetamol lowers temperature and paracetamol lowers pain. But we have extended paracetamol to improve sport performance. Like sports people typically take it for performance improvement. And it prevents atherosclerosis, and it also prevents cataract formation. So we know all these things without any explicit modeling. And here is the other famous case where a neural network was created using implicit knowledge. And we still don't understand how the neural network actually functions, but we have now managed to create all the fancier versions of it, like recurrent networks, deep learning networks, GANs, capsule network and all. So so we need some other theory to explain how implicit modeling leads to new kinds of optimization. So that is the phase two, where I will look at models as mind redesign engines. So I will start with this idea that new representations create new thinking, and they work like new interfaces. So you can see two mathematical representations here. One is the Roman numeral representation, and the other is the Indian numeral representation of 1968 divided by 28. And in the first case, you actually needed mathematicians to solve this problem using Roman numeral system. Then once the Indian numeral system came, you expect fourth graders, fifth graders to solve this very difficult problem. This example is given by Wilensky and Tapper to show that new representation systems are restructuring devices, which allow more people to become experts in technical knowledge. Now this example has been taken and extended by this designer. His name is Brett Victor. He has this article called Kill Math, which is worth reading. So he says, the symbolic mechanism of math evolved for a reason. It was the most efficient means of modeling quantitative systems given the constraints of pencil and paper. But we are no longer constrained by pencil and paper. The symbolic shuffle should no longer be taken for granted as the fundamental mechanism for understanding quantity and change. Then he says this very remarkable thing. He says math needs a new interface. So he treats these two as interfaces, and he says, now that we have more than print, we should be looking for new interfaces for mathematics. So here is the argument. So here is the old interface for the deductive computing machine, and here is the new interface for it. And what you can do in the new interface, like all the Instagramming, Facebooking, video editing, Photoshopping and all, cannot be even imagined with this system. So the moment the interface changed to this system, you can have all these new possibilities and touchscreen interfaces and all that kind of thing. Now, the argument is that, here is the interface for science and mathematics as it exists now. So there is the possibility of creating new interfaces, and what do those interfaces look like? And turns out there are some interfaces that illustrates the case. So here is a new interface for discovery. This is a protein folding video game developed by the University of Washington. It currently has around 740,000 players. And what they do is these players design novel protein folds by manipulating the structure you see on screen, which is essentially running on top of a very complex computational model that is doing free energy minimization. Now, the game development team posts real protein design puzzles periodically, and the current design problem is the COVID fighting proteins. Now, in 2005, this group published a paper in Nature along with folded players arguing that such model-based games, which couple people's tacit visual and spatial reasoning abilities to very complex computational models, could be a new method to solve challenging scientific problems. And turns out they were right. So new thinking were created by the new interface. So first of all, there was this folding prodigy. So a 13-year-old boy who proposed structures built using this interface won the first place in the hardest category in a worldwide experiment for protein structure prediction. And he beat out structures proposed by seasoned biochemists. So people with PhDs were predicting protein folds, and then this 13-year-old kid was making protein folds, and the 13-year-old kid won over the PhDs. Now here is another case where the gamers helped decipher the structure of an AIDS-causing monkey virus, producing a 3D model in 10 days. Now the problem had remained unsolved for 15 years. So that is, PhDs were fighting with this problem for 15 years. They could not solve it. Posted to fold it, solved by novices in 10 days. Paper published in Nature Biotechnology. Now the game allows people, the novices, to design drug molecules. And currently the ongoing design is a protein to blow up the coronavirus. Now spin-off systems have come out of it, ETRNA, which is a game for synthetic RNA design, where the interesting thing is that novices make these designs using the web-based interface, and a Stanford lab will actually synthesize those RNA structures. So one of my students was a top player in this game, and she was designing RNA sitting in Mumbai, and then structures that she was designing was actually synthesized by the lab, and then she was given feedback on it. And this process has provided new insights into RNA folding, lots of papers from there. And now there are many other such games, iWare, quantum moves, NanoCrafter, Philo, you can see all this. Now these, what do these interfaces do? They couple explicit and implicit reasoning. So explicit conceptual knowledge, which is developed by science experts, scientists, like structure of protein, possible folds, quantum dynamics and all, is redesigned for manipulation to create an interface that allows manipulation by novices. And then naive participants come in and use their implicit reasoning abilities like action and vision to generate novel patterns. Now this is a very important shift in the direction of knowledge flow in science, which, as we saw, has traditionally been from implicit to explicit. So recently it has been extended even further, where ETRNA people have taken gamers' actions and used that to train artificial neural network models to predict new folds, though the system only performs at 60% of the gamers' capabilities. So here the interesting thing is the gamers' actions are, as we saw, implicit. And the artificial neural network is again an implicit system because we don't understand it. So two implicit systems have been coupled together, and it makes interesting predictions about RNA folding. Now this approach is what is called human in the loop machine learning, and it is now being applied to this quantum moves game as well. So these games actually show a ongoing melding of knowledge modes. So the example is, think of some physiological function, like your liver is doing something, your kidney is doing something. It is doing whatever it is doing in an implicit kind of way. Now I develop a biochemical mechanism model of it that makes the physiological processes explicit. Then I take these mechanisms and then turn it into some procedural manipulation, which some gamers can come and manipulate. So that becomes an implicit system. And then I connect it to some machine learning system, and then together with the moves in the game and the machine learning system, new predictions are made. And then me, as somebody interested in cognition, tries to understand how this manipulation process creates new knowledge, and that will give you some explicit theory of this process. So that is another trajectory. And there are like multiple other trajectories that are possible. So the implicit to explicit trajectory that we saw before is only one of the possible trajectories. And the current research practices are melding explicit and implicit knowledge in novel kinds of ways. So one way to think about it is that the implicit and explicit was always connected together, even in the optimization case. And then now it is getting connected together in new kinds of ways to create new kinds of thinking. And then this process will keep on expanding, and then you will have new and better discoveries as it spirals more and more outwards. So it's like something like a tornado. This is assuming there is some structure, but because we are talking about the brain, things could be like very complicated, and then everything could be messed up like this. Now, so this gives you this idea of modeling as a mind redesign engine. So the idea is you build explicit models of phenomena like protein folding, RNA folding, quantum mechanics and all. Then you take that explicit models and build new interfaces which allow these models to be enacted and manipulated by novices. So all these systems. And that leads to allows you to build new phenomena based on the understanding that emerges from this process. So new proteins, new RNA folds, new computation, new metabolic pathways and all. So if you generalize the case, here is the coupling system that we saw in the optimization case. So you create all the explicit models, then you connect them to a new modeling interface, which recombines explicit and implicit thinking in new ways. So you have new kinds of thinking, and that leads to new materials, new computing systems, new flying machines, new possible worlds. Now, we can think of artificial neural network modeling also from this perspective. So you can think of it as, you know, doing some mind redesign, even though it is a black box. So you connect it to human-centered machine learning interfaces that will allow you to make new materials, new proteins, new computing, and new flying machines, and new possible worlds. Except that these systems don't currently exist. The only thing, only one that exists is that ETRNA one, but there are lots of people who are interested in creating human-centered machine learning. So the so summary of my talk in one slide, it is a historical case. Think of this deductive computing system in the 1960s. So that is the interface that you have for this system. So at this point, there are two research trajectories that are possible. One is a explanation trajectory, where you develop good explanations of how this system works, so that more people start working with this system. But that is not what Doug Engelbart did. So here is Engelbart presenting his mother of all demos, where the Windows icon mouse pointer interface was shown, as well as I think hypertext and then touch screens. So everything, most of what we play around with this in current computers was shown at that demo in 1968. So it developed this participation trajectory, where novel and action-based interfaces allowed anyone to work with this system. And that completely changed the nature of computing. So it created the computing revolution to the point that we are walking around with computers in our pockets. And it changed what kind of computing, what is computing. And it also created the graphic chips, which runs this inductive computing system in the 2020s. Of course, the inductive computing system is running on some deductive systems, but eventually we hope to have some neuromorphic system or something like that. Now, again, we are faced with these two trajectories, research trajectories. So the explanation trajectory is what explainable AI is advocating. So you develop good explanations of how this system makes discoveries. And I think that a participation trajectory would be better, where you develop new and action-based interfaces to allow anyone to make discoveries with this system. And this is better because historically that has been the case, like this approach has been more productive. And secondly, the explainable AI trajectory has all kinds of conceptual issues associated with it. I advocate moving towards a participatory machine learning trajectory. Now, there are other people who think along these lines. So MIT Human-Centered AI Group, Stanford Human-Centered AI Group, Oxford Human-Centered AI Group, all the usual suspects doing all the usual suspect-like things, all very new, like 2019-2020 kind of work. Here is a group in Netherlands where many universities have come together to create what is called the Hybrid Intelligence Center. And then Aarhus University, Denmark, which has a center for hybrid intelligence. And in India, our group is the one that is interested in this problem, as far as I know. But our interest is in a sort of wider sense. So we are interested in the science of learning in general. So we study the science of learning by building new computational media for learning and discovery. So what we call cultural learning and plasticity. But we build these systems by trying to understand cognitive and neural mechanisms that allow you to learn with this system, as well as other mechanisms that have been proposed. So we are interested also in the biological learning and plasticity mechanisms. And we model some of these mechanisms using artificial neural network architectures, particularly memory, emergence of memory. And today I have been talking about the possible connections between new ANN modeling architectures and new computational media, which can lead to advances in machine learning. And these are the interesting people who have allowed me to develop these thoughts, mostly students and interns and postdocs. And these are my funding agencies, Department of Atomic Energy, Department of Science and Technology, National Science Foundation. And questions. Thank you.
I There's so many things about that. I just wondered whether we sort of feel that I've always thought the explainable AI route is something that is challenging because there's so many things in terms of the way backpropagation works, for example, the adjustments of weights and so on. It's so hard to explain. It's almost like you know, people maybe give up on explainability and just go for reproducibility. So as long as you can reproduce it, you could then, I've always thought sort of, and then what? You know, when you get some, you know, an explanation, it's like, so what does that tell you about why a particular decision was taken? And with your participatory view, I wondered if you felt that whilst that sort of keeps the human sort of intuition, if you like, and maybe, you know, some sort of like step that was implicit in your examples. Does that mean that we can only, whilst it might speed up scientific research that would previously be sort of like, it could be AI human assisted, but does it mean that it would effectively sort of always need a human and wouldn't be just free running automated?
Yeah, that is the position I'm taking. So I'm just thinking about the artificial intelligence systems as a way of reconfiguring the mind. So because the mind was never considered in the previous discussions, like you are always talking about the world and the model and the relationship between the world and the model. So you talk about explanations. But remember, why do you need an explanation? You need an explanation for people to participate in the system. Like people should buy into the system. But you can have other ways of people participating. Explanation is only one of the ways you can create a participant, right?
Sure.
And why do we build these systems? Why do we build these complex systems? Why are we using artificial neural networks to model condensed matter physics? Because we have run into a situation where nothing else works. Only a system that is as complex as the brain can do the work that we currently need to do. So if you are going there, that means we have already given up on explanation. I mean, in fact, if you get into computational modeling, you have already given up on explanations. Because when you talk about emergence, you are essentially saying that there is no explanation.
Right, yeah.
So why not just hug the problem, right? Why not just, you know, be fall in love with it and then say that, you know, let us build systems which are implicit, you know, value the implicit system. Because the implicit system has created, given us so many things, including electromagnetism, including neural networks, including glass, including optics, thermodynamics. Like steam engines existed before thermodynamics came. So we don't appreciate the capacity of the implicit system. So people have said this, like, you know, so in the first two talks, they said that scientific intuition is very powerful and we should value it. But I'm saying it is not just scientific intuition that is powerful. It is everyday intuition that is powerful, which is redeployed for science. So we can still use that, you know, like a 13-year-old kid can go into that folded interface and create biomolecules. So why can't other people do it? Like, you know, why are we waiting for an explanation for it?
Yeah, fascinating. I wondered about the relationship between, I guess, non-determinism when I saw the Lorenz attractor in the earlier part of your talk. And I was thinking how we jump from being sort of modeling, you know, this sort of like amorphous, implicit thing that we have these labels like intuition and so on, and we don't really actually really understand what that really is. And certainly when we start to think, well, it's non-deterministic, it's like, as you say, we're kind of like, you know, we might as well take the step and say, well, as a result of it happening, then we're going to have to sort of live with it and try to sort of work with it, as opposed to try to break it down and understand it, you know. We have a question in the chat. It's a question from Dr. Jansen from yesterday. In what sense do we not understand, in quotes, ANNs? We know exactly how forward backpropagation works and how backpropagation works from a statistical learning perspective. We know an ANN is a distribution estimator. What we don't know, even after training the network, is exactly what distribution it's learned. But how is that different from the symbolic long division algorithm? I know how it works and I use it exactly because I can't see the answer in advance. I'm trying to understand what understand means here.
Yeah, so that is actually not my problem, because explainable AI is somebody else's problem, right? but to answer the question, I mean, see, what people don't understand is what is it doing in real time? So in computing time, like, what is it actually doing? Like, if I talk about long division, I can say these are the steps, yada, yada, yada. But if you ask, like, what exactly is this system doing, like, why is it doing it and all, like, there is no answer to it. So when people say that, I want an explanation for how did you reach this step from this step. So that is what is missing. So you said there is this black box, which has this magical property of giving you generalizations. But I mean, again, it is not my problem, because I think that going that direction is, like, you know, completely unproductive. See, we are going there because we are fascinated by the idea that we have explanations currently, or some stories when you get into computational modeling, you sort of give up most explanations, but you still sort of have some, you know, structures that we used to use in the older cases and all. So we are sort of beholden to that idea. So we think that anything that we come up with as a model should actually have some explanation in that sense. So I agree with Ben, like, in the sense that even there we may not know it, right? So the implicit is, you know, again, undervalued there. So we somehow created these explicit and external models, and then we fell in love with it. And then we thought that, you know, the implicit has just gone away, right? You know, I climbed the implicit ladder and then I threw away the ladder. Now I live in this, explicit modeling world. And then everything is hunky-dory now, right? Now it has come back with a vengeance, because the data is exploding in your face and you don't know what to do with it. So you are now marrying all kinds of implicit things, like including the sensory motor system, the artificial neural network, which is a model of the brain, which, you know, like I said, there are all these conceptual issues. Like, you are using a plastic system to model non-plastic things, or what we consider as non-plastic.
Right. Yeah. Just running ahead, because we've had a couple of questions come in as we've been speaking, so we'll try to get through a couple of those. If we don't get through them, perhaps if you're well enough, if you could sort of answer them.
I'm actually feeling much better now.
Oh, okay, good. Well, that's good. You see, that's what science and AI and a good symposium can do.
Yeah.
Because we don't understand the paracetamol, so we might as well be the symposium that's done it.
Yeah.
Does participatory AI run into the risk of erroneous conclusions on unknown areas? Explainable AI would at least give us a hint on whether the conclusions are correct or not. An interesting question.
So of course it does, right? I don't think that explainable AI is, again, this perfect algorithm. But participatory AI has the advantage that it is crowdsourced. So there are many eyes looking at the problem, and there are agreements that are forming between different groups, and there is arguments that are developing about, you know, optimal structures and all. So yes, it will run into, you know, different cul-de-sacs and all, but then it has mechanisms that will get it out of that cul-de-sac. So, which I think is an advantage, right? So norms will come, but the norms will come in an emergent way, rather than like some philosopher of science is saying that this is the sort of normative things that needs to be done.
Right. And very quickly, one final super quick question. Going by the definition of implicit systems, isn't intuition in itself an implicit model of thinking?
Okay, can you say that once more?
Going by the definition of implicit systems, isn't intuition in itself the implicit model of thinking?
Yes. I mean, like, when I say implicit, it sort of covers intuition. Like, anything that is not laid out in a rule-like fashion, that is what I'm calling implicit. I mean, there is mostly it is like, I was talking only about the sensory motor system, but that covers a significant chunk of. So just so give some respect to the implicit system. That is all, you know, the message of the talk.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you so much. That was absolutely fascinating. And we're going to take a short break now for about 10 minutes. But what I would just want to pose a quick question for you to consider over the break, and then just, you know, put it in the chats, you know, now or over the break or even after the break, is another open-ended question. What do you think what is your opinion of the most exciting AI developments or discovery? What do you think is the sort of the biggest hitting thing in AI that you, in your experience? and it'll be interesting to see what you feel. So we'll see you back in 10 minutes, and stay tuned. Thank you.